Look, we're almost there. Thanks for watching the BE3 pre-show.
Everyone, my name is Morgan Webb.
And I'm Adam Sessler.
And we would like to welcome everyone to the 2016 Bethesda E3 Showcase. We are inside the LA Hangar. This is a massive space that Bethesda has completely taken over and built out special for this year's big event. This venue is so big, it's actually become the sixth largest theater in the state of California.
And we're here with almost 2,000 people, including press, industry stalwarts, and most importantly, hundreds of Bethesda's biggest fans. Just like last year's showcase, Bethesda has opened the doors to the people who play their games. And along with all of you watching this live stream, we'll be getting a first look at the games to play for years to come.
Now, the showcase is going to begin in about 20 minutes, but it's not just about the stage show. Right after the showcase, we'll be back here live with exclusive interviews with all the developers behind the games you just saw on stage.
It'll all take place during what Bethesda is calling BE3 Plus. A big celebration with live game demos and more. We'll take you inside BE3 Plus, show you all the amazing stuff that's on display, and dig deep to reveal even more info about all the games you'll see tonight.
The fog can do a number on you. Get you all turned around.
Far Harbor has a right to the truth.
The people of Far Harbor need only peer out their windows to look upon the face of Atom himself. Given form in holy fog.
I know peace can still be achieved.
Peace? You call murdering one of ours peace?
Careful. This could get out of hand real fast.
See? Creepy?
Yes.
Creepy and fun. Mm-hmm. Here's another fun fact. Yeah. I love bipedal fish creatures. They're my only friends in my fantasy life.
They have the lures on their heads. They're really
exactly.
cool.
Exactly. So, yeah. Morgan, do you actually have a favorite moment from Fallout 4?
I spent so much time getting my settlements up and running and trying to make them look a little bit nicer. I mean, slapping a painting on that rotted out wall, I think it really spruces the place up a little bit, doesn't it?
Yes, yes. It really ties the whole lean-to together.
Yes.
Now, I have to be honest, I really love the freedom to build in Fallout 4.
Yeah.
And I really, really did try to make things nicer for my settlers, and I failed all of them. Even in the apocalypse, I am not Jonathan Adler.
I think they should be happy that they have beds, right? Mm-hmm. They always complain to me about their sleeping arrangements. Did they not see my painting? I crafted that myself.
All that time and apocalyptic paint. No, I got to the point where I'd just be slapping down the sleeping bag and like, here, is that good enough for you? Oh, you want a roof over your head, I see. Well, too bad, because this is what you get. What other people actually can pull off in creating those settlements is absolutely incredible.
I know, they did better than me, so you guys should get ready to get jealous.
All right, I think this is true for many, many people.
Yep.
I love the setting of Fallout 4, especially, you know, in those denser parts of Boston and how it juxtaposed that Fallout sci-fi with actual historical locales. And I also remember just how awestruck I was the first time I stepped into Diamond City. It was just like, wow, this is like some kind of odd fantasy horror in my mind.
Yes, the Great Green Jewel.
Yes.
You guys should totally try the Power Noodles. They're worth the price. I didn't really think he was a baseball fan, though. That's why I'm a little surprised about it.
Well, no one ever really presented baseball from a survivalist perspective before, so it really kind of got to me. Now, there was also this time, and this is very, very true. I stepped inside the Massachusetts State House just to, like, maybe pick up some aluminum and some glue because, you know, you need all the glue in the world.
You have a lot of people relying on you.
Now, about 2 hours later, I'm still there. I don't know how far underground I'm going, and I'm just fighting bigger and bigger Mire Lurks. It was just one of those wonderful, surprising moments about the game.
Yeah, so who's your favorite character?
Nick Valentine, hands down. He's actually probably one of my most favorite characters in any game ever. I love detectives. If I lived in a fantasy world where things were more mysterious, I would be a detective. So hanging with him and going through his special quest was just deeply satisfying. I mean, the idea of having a world-weary noir robot gumshoe as your buddy, that won me over.
Pretty much had your name written all over it. I can say that my favorite thing actually was probably having the Pip-Boy on my iPad. I'm completely obsessed with it. It made it very convenient. I can probably blame some of my deaths on not actually paying attention playing on my iPad. So
I'm leveling up. Oh, I'm dead.
Oh, I'm not leveling up anymore. Why isn't this working
Yes.
Right.
Well, speaking of tablets.
Yes.
Aha, transition.
I love it.
We can't forget about Fallout Shelter. At last year's showcase, Bethesda both announced and released Fallout Shelter. And since then, it has become the most played title from Bethesda Game Studios. Are you still playing Shelter?
I am, because I have to make sure my resource-sucking babies are going to grow up to be productive members of society that I can exploit for more resources. Kids are useless. Oh, I did name one of them after you, though.
Really hope you didn't send him to the barbershop for a haircut.
No, because I systematically bred baldness out of my vault.
You monster! Oh, okay. Can you at least put me in a room with the parrot? I love the pets in the game, but I'm all down with the parrots.
All right, I will hook you up with a parrot to make all your weirdo pirate fantasies come true.
Argy!
Okay. There are other updates to Fallout Shelter. They also added rooms for crafting items. They added a day and night cycle, new weapons and armor, and new characters, including Old Longfellow, who's the new companion you meet in Fallout 4's Far Harbor.
Far Harbor. Shelter, though, is not the only place where you can be crafty. Bethesda began to officially support mods for Fallout 4 with the release of the PC Creation Kit in April. And you can now check out the thousands of available mods and install them directly in your game, or you can browse them online at Bethesda.net.
Now, even better, Fallout 4 mods are not limited to just the PC anymore. While they're still created on the PC, you can now install mods on the console. In May, mods came to Xbox One, and they're arriving on PlayStation 4 later this month.
So let's take a look at some of the coolest Fallout 4 mods. You know, to be fair, that really just scratches the surface of what's available out there as a mod. And I've always been amazed at how creative people are them. It's like with the shelters and the apocalypse. I am just proud to get my pants on in one try.
We're proud of you, too.
Yeah. Fallout fans really know how to go all out.
Okay, but not just Fallout fans. Doom fans know how to go all out, too.
That's right. Doom was released last month, reminding gamers that the best way to win something is to keep moving forward and never stop.
Always moving forward. When everyone got to see the original gameplay demo at Bethesda's E3 showcase last year, people were amazed at the fast pace. But when we sat down to play, we got to see the depth of the game. I love the rune challenges. I know you are still working on some of those.
Yes, that Rich and Richer challenge.
With
the rocket launcher. Yeah, yeah. Tweeted me any advice on how I can do this. I am stuck.
We should track down one of the devs to do that for you. That's their job, right?
Oh, that's right. We're here at Bethesda.
Yeah, right? There's
something more convenient. Still, tweet at me, whatever. Anyway, I also like to unlock those classic maps because it really does highlight just how much gaming has changed from when the original Doom really... It didn't create, it wasn't the first, but it really, you know, started the FPS movement. If you want to make something with a classic feel, you can also do that in Snap Map.
Yes, and Snap Map is kind of fun for a couple reasons. First, somebody always makes a really, really easy map that gives you a billion points. That's the one that I play first. and then second, people make some really interesting and imaginative things.
Now, if you guys haven't played around with Snap Map, it's pretty easy when you get started, and it gets really deep if you want to dig in. Things just snap together, hence the name, Snap Map. And you can scroll through available options. You can place every enemy individually, or you can let the AI place them for you. You can create the triggers to spawn enemies, or put them all in one. Room to build a really uncomfortable hellspawn mixer, or you can do a lot and you can do a little.
Yeah, and you also, what I love is you have a lot of control over the look and feel of the environment. There are way more options than I imagined. So I was inspired by the grainy filter to work on a film noir adventure with demons. However, I am actually sad to report Fedora's not part of Snap Map. I was disappointed too.
Because they're part of every aspect of gaming.
But if that's not enough for you, there is, of course, competitive multiplayer.
Yes, and you know, the
else knows him as Boxman. Would you mind just trying that on for one quick sec? I just got to see this. Yeah, that's really, really, really effective.
And what was the inspiration behind this costume? Like, you know, what spoke to you about it?
It just took us like 2 days to finish The Evil Within, and we played that like all night, and that was giving us like little heart attacks, and we just fell in love with the game.
So what else are you guys excited about? What are you excited to see here today?
For one, gameplay for Dishonored 2, because we've been so excited. Just the first trailer from last year, waiting in line for hours. We're just like, yeah, I hope we get to see other stuff. Maybe Elder Scrolls? Maybe new Elder Scrolls?
Well, actually, going back to Dishonored 2, I mean, now we have an adult grown-up Emily Caldwin. Is that something you're considering for cosplay?
I'm actually working on doing Emily. I started the scarf last year, and I've been thinking about, like, what swashes I'm going to use, like, what kind of fabric, and trying to put it all together and trying to make it nice, maybe for PAX, maybe for later on, maybe this next year, but it's going to get done.
All right, well, I'm really looking forward to it. And on that note, I think all four of us and so many other people out there are excited for another and maybe deeper look at Dishonored 2. But let's right now look at last year's trailer to get us all excited.
It's happened again. Someone's pulled the rug out from under you. An empire at your feet, and you've lost it all. Be honest, did you really deserve any of it? More important, what would you do to get it back? Careful, there's always a price to pay. What you decide will ripple across the years. Blood in the gutters and corruption on the wind. It'll be fun watching this unfold. What will you do with the power I've given you? How will you make your mark on this wretched world?
cover your face, but I know who you are. Emily Caldwin. Nothing is an accident. Everything is in motion. All of it has led you to this exact second in time.
Before you strike, if you kill me, you become the assassin we claimed you were. You become one of us!
The years are long, but it's always good to see a familiar face.
Excited for that. I think some people in here might be excited for that
too. Excited. That's a nice understated term. Well,
yes.
You will not have to wait long. Bethesda has announced that Dishonored 2 will be available worldwide on PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC November 11th.
Now you play as either, I know they're excited for that too. You play as either Emily Caldwin, who we just saw in the video and who looks super awesome and who's who I'm going to play as, or Corvo Otano, who is also pretty awesome, but I am playing as Emily.
Well, both characters are fully voiced and they bring a different perspective and play style depending on which one you play. So, you know, there's a good reason to maybe play both.
I guess. They do have different powers also. If you played the first game, you're going to be familiar with Corvo's. They are going to be significantly upgraded. Emily's are actually all new, so as always, there are going to be tons and tons of ways to play the game. But I do want to make a note of the location that we saw in the trailer. It has a very different feel than that sort of industrial Dunwall that we saw in the first game.
So the city is called Karnaca, which is really fun to say. Try it all together. Karnaca. Karnaca, Karnaca. It's like Machiku Kakutani, you know? It's just fun. It rolls off the tongue. Anyway, it's based on Mediterranean, southern Mediterranean countries like Greece and Italy. But what I noticed was the significant verticality of the city. Does this mean that, you know, we're going to be going really, really high, be up in the clouds, getting vertigo, and that's how we're going to be doing the sneaking around?
At least Emily will be when I play as her.
Okay, you're going to play as Emily.
Did I mention that?
I think you did.
You know what I didn't see in Karnaca, though? I didn't see.
What didn't you see?
Rats.
Rats? Maybe rats, yes. Yes, there are significantly less rats in Dishonored 2, unless you use Corvo's Devouring Swarm, because then you're going to have some rats there.
Right.
Although, I don't know, the rats seem to be a little bit more pleasurable next to the blood flies. Karnaca seems to be filled with blood flies. That sounds so friendly and warm and cuddly.
They're kind of cute. But we both have a significant amount of affection for Dishonored, rats and all.
Yes, we do. It was my personal game of the year back in 2012, the year that it came out, and I played through it 3 times since then. And I would say, if you haven't had the chance to play it, I do highly recommend the Dishonored Definitive Edition, which is on current-gen systems with all the DLC included. Having said that, if you haven't played the original, trust me, you can jump right into Dishonored 2 without a worry.
All right, guys, I think we've had enough speculation, don't you?
I think so. I think so.
I have a sneaking suspicion that we're going to see a lot more Dishonored 2 tonight.
I have one of those sneaking suspicions as well. I don't know where it's coming from. All right, guys, the showcase is about to start, but we will be back in an hour with exclusive interviews and new info. So please stay tuned to the live stream and follow along on Twitter, @Bethesda, with the hashtag BE3.
And send us your questions and comments. If we read yours, you might even nab a special giveaway that you want. You want it. Trust me.
All right. They're timing me. I'm getting excited. Everyone here getting excited? Yeah. All right. Where are we? 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. All right, guys.
One.
Enjoy the show.
Enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Studio Director of id Software, Tim Willits.
Good evening, and welcome to the Bethesda E3 Showcase. Yes, Quake is back. The game that defined competitive multiplayer is back and better than ever. You know, it's hard to believe that 20 years ago, Quake was first released. And, you know, if you'll excuse the pun, the aftershocks can still be felt to this day. Quake set new standards for multiplayer and pushed the boundaries for graphics and gameplay. Quake also became a pioneer for esports. And 20 years later, Quake is still played in tournaments across the globe. The biggest of those tournaments is our very own annual gathering, QuakeCon, which will attract this August tens of thousands of people to Dallas. As a co-designer of the original game, I'm extremely proud and excited to be standing here today to announce the next chapter of this great game, Quake Champions. Quake Champions is a competitive, arena-style, first-person shooter for the PC, designed for players of all skill levels. Whether you are new to Quake or have been fragging for the last 20 years, Quake Champions will give you the challenge and rush you'd expect from id Software multiplayer games. Now, we know that high-end performance is critical with this type of game. You know, so be assured, as with any id Software game, that Quake Champions will be fast, with amazing graphics running at 120 hertz with unlocked frame rates. Yes. You're gonna get heart-stopping action that will keep you on the edge of your seat as you fight in classic arena combat. Quake Champions also taps into another hallmark of the franchise, unique and badass characters. The game features a diverse cast of warriors, each with different attributes and unique abilities, allowing you to fight the way that you want. And you know that id has a long tradition of supporting competitive tournaments, and that continues with Quake Champions. The game is designed for world-class esports play at every level, from the world's greatest Quake players to anyone willing to test their skills in the arena. So as part of the launch plan for Quake Champions, Bethesda will be supporting and expanding competitive tournaments and leagues beyond QuakeCon. And we'll have more to share about that in the coming months. I hope you enjoyed this sneak peek into our newest game. Join us at QuakeCon in August, and we'll have even more to talk about. And now, please join me in welcoming Bethesda's Global Vice President of PR and Marketing, Pete Hines.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Tim. As Tim said, we'll have even more to show on Quake Champions this August at QuakeCon. I mean, it's right there in the name. How would we not have our new Quake game at QuakeCon? Make any sense? But right now, we're not at QuakeCon. We're at E3, the biggest week in gaming, and this is the Bethesda E3 Showcase. So welcome to everyone here with me and to the millions of you watching online around the world. Thank you for joining us. We planned this showcase just like we make all of our games for you. Now last year our showcase kicked off a big year for Bethesda, one of the biggest in our many years of making games. So let me mention just a few highlights. The Elder Scrolls Online was released on console and became one of the best-selling games of 2015 and was named MMO of the Year. We launched Fallout Shelter, the very first mobile game from Bethesda Game Studios, and it became an instant hit and winner of multiple Mobile Game of the Year awards. In November, Fallout 4 was one of the biggest launches in the industry. So you've heard of it, good. And won numerous Game of the Year awards, including at DICE and again at the BAFTA Awards. And now Fallout 4 is bringing user mods to Xbox One and soon to PS4 in a way that's never been seen before. And just last month, the new Doom was released to rave reviews. Now, the original Doom almost single-handedly popularized first-person shooter games, and now you have a new Doom game, faithful to its legacy with some of the best graphics and gameplay ever, and millions of fans have been enjoying the fast-paced action and creating and sharing mods using SnapMap. The response to all of these games has been amazing, and your enthusiasm and support for us has encouraged us to go even bigger. You just heard about our new Quake game. Let's see what else we have planned for you guys. At last year's showcase, I told you about The Elder Scrolls Legends, a free-to-play collectible card game. Now, as I said last year, I am a huge fan of these games. I play them a lot. So this is a game I'm particularly excited about. Legends provides a very deep strategy experience through both single and multiplayer modes, beginning with a campaign complete with a compelling story, interesting characters, and some great gameplay. The story is told from the perspective of a Moth Priest named Kellan. I'll let him tell you a little more as we take a look at the campaign's opening cinematic.
The Elder Scrolls show us what was and what yet will be. And they have revealed much to me.
Spare us your stories, old man, unless they can sharpen spears. Our war chief is dying. Our enemies are massing for another attack. We must prepare for battle.
We should go, Kellan. We have the scroll we came for, and this one smells blood in the wind.
Patience, Nog. I have words yet to speak here. Stories can do surprising things, Spear Maiden, whether they are true or not. Fled north, giving Cyrodiil to the invaders. This is the story of a forgotten hero who changed the very course of history.
When Legends begins, you're set on a path to discover the world of the Elder Scrolls in a way you haven't seen before. The choices you make define your approach and unlock all the depth the game has to offer. A two-lane battlefield provides more variety and strategic depth. Players make decisions that change the cards they want to improve or add to their decks, and we offer a full single-player campaign, as well as multiple ways to play against the AI or other players in both battle and arena modes. Now, we began public beta testing in April, and so far the feedback from the people who have been playing has been terrific. To celebrate E3 this week, we'll be letting even more of you into the beta to start playing. Now, if you haven't signed up yet, just visit Bethesda.net, create an account, and sign up, and be sure to keep an eye on your email. Also tonight, we're very pleased to announce that in addition to PC and iPad, Legends will be coming to iPhone, Mac, and Android tablets and phones later this year. As I said, I'm very excited about Legends as it brings together an award-winning franchise that I love and a new genre, and whether you're a veteran strategy card fan or have never played a game before, it's a game we think you'll all really enjoy. And now, so long as we're on the topic of Legends, let's take a look at what the team at Bethesda Game Studio has been hard at work on.
Welcome here to Bethesda Game Studios. It's amazing to think it has only been a year since you first heard about Fallout 4 at this very event. And thanks to you, it became not just our most popular game ever, but one of the industries. It has simply blown us away, and we're incredibly blessed to have fans like you. Seeing what you've created, not just in the main game with the add-ons and of course mods, it is just incredible. And we're not done yet. We're excited to show you what's coming next for Fallout 4. Of course, we didn't just announce Fallout 4 last year, we also announced and released Fallout Shelter, which over 50 million of you have downloaded and played. We have a really big update coming out. Take a look. We hope you're as excited as we are about all of this stuff coming to Fallout. We want to thank you again, not just for your support over the last year, but your support of our whole studio really over the last 20 years. There is something else though that you've been asking us about, and yes, we've been working on it.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the president and co-creative director of Arkane Studios, Rafael Colantonio.
Thank you. Hi everyone, I'm very excited to be here tonight on behalf of Arkane Studios, the makers of Dishonored. Our passion is for a very specific kind of game, first-person immersive games. Our games blend narration and simulation in a way that makes every player's experience different, where players can improvise and where choices have consequence. Our games encourage replay in order to try different playstyles so that players are free to play their own way. In 2012, we released Dishonored. We were thrilled that the game was so well received by the gamers and the critics all around the world. That was like one of the best feelings for us developers. After that launch, my friend and co-director Harvey Smith took the lead on Dishonored 2. So he went to France in Lyon and worked with the team over there. Meanwhile, I have been busy in Austin working on something else with the team in Austin. And tonight, I have a surprise for you. I'm going to reveal what that surprise is in a minute. It's a new game built on the values that are so dear to Arkane. It's another first-person immersive game set in a dangerous universe, only this time we've added a psychological thrill. Here is the world's first look at what we've been up to.
Good morning, Morgan. Today is Monday, March 15th, 2032. You have a 9 a.m. appointment with Alex in his office. There is no duration set for this meeting. There is a 3 p.m. meeting in Transtar Conference Room A to greenlight research and development plans. Please confirm your attendance prior to arrival. The most recent test results from the psychotron. Good morning, Morgan. Today is Monday, March 15th, 2032. You have a 9 a.m. appointment with Alex in his office. Good morning, Morgan. Today is Monday, March 15th, 2032.
Good morning, Morgan. Looks like we have some tests to run through today.
Good morning, Morgan. You're not going to like what I have to say next.
In Prey, you awaken aboard Talos One, a very special space station. It is year 2032. You are the key subject of an experiment meant to alter humanity forever. But things have gone wrong, of course. The space station has been overrun by an alien threat, and you are now being hunted. As you dig into the dark secrets of Talos One and your own past, you must survive using all the tools at your disposal on board of the station. Your wits, weapons, and mind-bending abilities. Prey will be available next year on Xbox One, PS4, and PC. We'll have more to show at the QuakeCon, so be sure to join us there. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Marty Stratton, executive producer of Doom at id Software. Last month, we had the privilege of releasing one of the most iconic titles in our industry to fans around the world. We challenged ourselves to ensure Doom lived up to its incredible legacy, and we thank you, our fans, for making the Doom launch such a tremendous success. It's been amazing to watch and hear from the millions of players enjoying the many aspects of the game. From those of you gunning for the perfect run through the campaign, to others constantly testing their skills in multiplayer, you continue to inspire our team. Last year, we told you we wanted to put the power of creation in the hands of every player through Doom Snapmap, allowing for an endless stream of new gameplay. And in the coming months, we're excited to be supporting Doom Snapmap with free updates and even more ways to play. We'll be delivering new construction modules, including hell visual themes, as well as new props, objects, weapons, and items. While creators can look forward to new logic options and functionality, like the ability to create true single-player experiences with features like the popular weapon wheel found in the campaign. And again, throughout the year, every Snapmap feature and update is free for every player. For multiplayer, Next month, we'll release two new modes, including a uniquely Doom variant of One Flag CTF called Exodus, as well as an all-new multi-zone capture and hold mode called Sector. Later this summer, we'll turn up the heat with the release of three free-for-all modes, including Classic Deathmatch. These modes will be free to all players and playable on any existing or future maps. Also next month, fans can look forward to our first premium Doom DLC pack, Unto the Evil. The first DLC pack includes three new multiplayer maps, Offering, Cataclysm, and Ritual. A new playable demon called the Harvester, a new gun, equipment item, armor sets, taunts, and more. With just a month passed since our launch, we hope you've only scratched the surface of fun we packed into the game. And we can't wait to give you even more ways to compete, create, play, and fight like hell. Thank you.
Wow, ton of great stuff there for everyone that's enjoying Doom. And again, we thank you, the fans, for making it such a hit. Doom has received near universal acclaim from critics and players alike for its fast combat, over-the-top demons, and amazing graphics, everything that it is known for. Now, it is also known as a longtime supporter of shareware, or for you youngsters in the audience, that's what us old guys used to call a demo. And in a nod to that tradition, we've decided to offer anyone that hasn't checked out Doom's amazing gameplay a chance to do it for free. So, starting tonight, you can download and play the first level of Doom on Steam, PS4, or Xbox One for free. Now, this offer is only good this week, but we want everyone to have a chance to see why Doom is one of the highest-rated shooters ever. So if you love super intense action or you just want to experience state-of-the-art gaming, go download Doom and fight like hell on us. We think you'll see what everyone else is talking about. Now, let's shift from Demons of Hell to Daedric Princes and Secret Assassin Cults. Please welcome from ZeniMax Online Studios, the Elder Scrolls Online game director, Matt Firer. Matt?
Thanks, everyone. Good evening. This week is the one-year anniversary of the launch of the Elder Scrolls Online on Xbox One and PlayStation 4. Because we were launching the game this time last year, I was a little busy and I wasn't able to be here in person, but I made sure I was here this year to tell everyone what's been happening with the Elder Scrolls Online. From the console launch last June to the release of three critically acclaimed DLC game packs during the year, all of us at ZeniMax Online have been really, really busy. But before I go any further, I want to take a moment and thank all of our fans for your support, your enthusiasm, and your feedback. We take it really seriously and we continue to work to improve the game. And based on the response, you like the changes. Elder Scrolls Online was named the best MMOG of 2015, was one of the best-selling games of the year of any kind, and now supports a highly engaged community of over 7 million of you who have been exploring this enormous world of Tamriel. Let's take a look at some of the highlights from the Elder Scrolls Online from launch onward. As you can see, the Elder Scrolls Online community is having a lot of fun playing the game. And our player community is still growing. Tonight, I'm very happy to announce that on June 23rd, we'll be expanding internationally by launching Elder Scrolls Online in Japan. We look forward to welcoming these fellow adventurers to the exciting world of Tamriel. And for everyone who plays, we have a lot more great content on the way. For me, one of my favorite moments in any RPG ever was the Dark Brotherhood quest in The Elder Scrolls IV Oblivion. It was packed full of assassination and intrigue, and like me, fans everywhere loved it. So I'm particularly excited for the launch of the Dark Brotherhood DLC game pack on Xbox One and PlayStation 4 this Tuesday. In the Dark Brotherhood DLC, you'll travel to another location from Oblivion, the Gold Coast of Cyrodiil. The Dark Brotherhood has an appropriately dark storyline full of intrigue and mystery and brings all new repeatable quest gameplay to ESO. So please enjoy the worldwide debut of the Dark Brotherhood DLC launch trailer.
Sweet mother, sweet mother, send your child unto me. For the sins of the unworthy must be baptized in blood and fear. This is the Black Sacrament Initiate, a contract that calls for murder. Now go, assassin. Take your blade into the night. Be rewarded for your service. In our business of death. Welcome, initiate, to the Dark Brotherhood. And know this, in Tamriel, no one is safe. Especially from us.
Sweet mother, send your child unto me.
Our PC players are already having fun sneaking around Tamriel and learning more about this mysterious group. And we can't wait to see what happens when our console players get to experience the Dark Brotherhood this week. But that's not all. A core philosophy in the Elder Scrolls Online is to constantly make the game better. Since launch, we've regularly been adding innovative features such as the Justice System and the Champion System, and we're about to make another game changer. Tonight, we're announcing One Tamriel, marking another major evolution of gameplay in the Elder Scrolls Online. With One Tamriel, all characters will be automatically leveled to content in the world, allowing them to freely group with anyone they want, and also to explore the vast world of Tamriel with no level restrictions. This means all content barriers are gone and there are no restrictions on alliances or questing. From the moment you get out of the tutorial, the entire game world is open for you to explore freely. You can go wherever you want and play with whomever you want. This is the first time this has ever been done in a multi-platform RPG. We'll think you'll love it. One Tamriel will be coming to the Elder Scrolls Online this fall. In closing, I want to thank the awesome Elder Scrolls Online community for your support. We never take it for granted. We work hard every day to make your Elder Scrolls Online experience the awesome adventure you want and deserve. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Matt. Well done. Now, we want you to get as much as possible out of this year's showcase. So, this year, after we're done here in the hangar, we're just going to keep the showcase going. Now, for those of you watching at home, our pre-show hosts, Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb, will be back to take over the stream, and they'll bring you exclusive interviews and more information about all the games that we're talking about here tonight. Here in Los Angeles, we've built an interactive space. Over on the other side of the lot, we have a chance to learn more about our games, play some of them, and meet some of our developers. Over there, there is also food, drink, and to make sure it's a real party, we have arranged a special performance by Blink-182, who will drop their new album, California, in a couple of weeks, and you get to hear them live tonight as they start their summer tour. Now we have another treat for you over there as well, a chance to experience the latest in virtual reality from Bethesda. Ooh. Weren't expecting that, were you? Now, the first time anyone experienced modern VR was at E3 2012, and if you were there and lucky enough, you may remember getting to play Doom 3 BFG in our booth. Now, at the time, we had solved some of the toughest technology challenges posed by VR, and people were amazed. Since then, we've quietly continued our pioneering work in VR, and tonight, we want you to see and experience what you feel when you put on a headset and play the latest AAA games in the industry. Now, we have two games for you to experience. The first is the just-released Doom. You can take a virtual tour of hell and get a totally unique look at the very latest in graphics and true next-gen rendering from our id Tech 6 engine. In addition, we think the greatest promise of VR is its ability to immerse players completely into virtual worlds, and that the best games for that experience will be first-person open-world RPGs. So we have Fallout 4 for you to play as well. Wander the wasteland, check out the iconic Red Rocket, try combat. I'm telling you, with a Pip-Boy on your arm, a dog by your side, a gun in your hand, it's pretty incredible. Tonight, we're pleased to announce that Fallout 4 will be released in 2017 on the HTC Vive platform. And if you thought survival mode was an intense way to experience Fallout, you ain't seen nothing yet. We want to give you a glimpse into where we're headed with VR, where you can expect us to remain a leader, offering our games on the very best platforms you choose. So be sure to check it out. Now, for more on the second half of the showcase, let's check in with Adam and Morgan to see what's happening and get an update on what they have planned. Adam, Morgan, what do you have for us?
Thanks, Pete. Now, we are here at BE3 Plus, and this is sort of this experience that you guys are going to get to see after the showcase. We have some Bethesda VR over here. Now, right now, there's no line, so that's kind of tempting, isn't it?
So taking advantage of that. And over here, Elder Scrolls Legends for everyone to play. Pete, I fully expect to see you at one of these tables showing off that card mastery skill I know you possess.
Now, in here, we're actually, Adam and I are actually going to be interviewing some of the developers that you guys just saw their games on stage, so we're going to have a lot more information for you. So everybody on the stream needs to stay tuned for that after
Definitely.
The showcase.
Lots of good info, but for the moment, let's go back to Pete and even more games.
Thank you, Adam and Morgan. We will see you guys in a few minutes. But we are not going anywhere just yet because there is one more thing that we think you are going to want to see. Last year, we announced that a sequel to Dishonored was in development, marking a new chapter to the Game of the Year from Arkane Studios. We shared a few tidbits about the sequel, but for the most part, you could say we've been in stealth mode. Until now. Sorry, I couldn't help myself. Dishonored 2 is going to be a very special game, one that lives up to its celebrated legacy and then goes way beyond. To tell you more, please join me in welcoming the creative director of Dishonored 2, Harvey Smith.
Wow. Thanks, Pete. Hi, everybody. In Dishonored, you play a supernatural assassin in a steampunk city. The game blends combat, stealth, and mobility, giving you many different pathways and approaches. When the original Dishonored was released in 2012, you embraced the game and made it your own. You discovered moves and combinations of powers that we didn't even imagine. We were thrilled by your passion for Dishonored, and we were humbled by the success of the game, which won more than 100 Game of the Year awards. At last year's E3, we announced Dishonored 2. So tonight, here with all of you for the first time, we're going to show you the game. Welcome back to the Empire of the Isles, a rich Victorian-inspired fantasy world with a distinct style and an exotic cast of characters. For Dishonored 2, we wanted to explore a new location, Karnaca, the jewel of the South. Our approach to world creation is very layered. Our art and design teams work together to create a strong sense of place with a well-realized culture. It's based on the people living there, the work they do, the architecture, economy, the climate, even the food and songs. In order to bring Karnaca to life, we've created a custom game engine designed to support our signature art direction and level design. We wanted Dishonored 2 to resemble a painting in motion, so we've given considerable thought to our lighting and the way it plays across every surface. We've created custom tools to support the interruptible, real-time narrative scenes necessary for a stealth simulation. And the same is true for our approach to audio, both in terms of atmospherics and stealth gameplay. All of these details make Karnaca more vivid, thanks to our new technology, which we call the Void Engine. In crafting spaces for you to explore, we've got several creative goals. We want the environment to feel coherent and complete, plausible. Where do these characters live and how do they get to work? Is there a viable pathway that makes sense? Where do they take their breaks or stop for lunch? But it goes further than that. For Dishonored 2, we felt compelled to ask ourselves about the history of a given street or shop. What was there a decade before the player arrives in Karnaca? Often, you can see the layers of history, watermarks on the wall from past floods, peeling posters and advertisements from years ago. We want every market, every alley to tell a story and offer you the chance to see something novel or intriguing. Dishonored 2 starts and ends in Dunwall, but most of the action takes place here in Karnaca. All right, there you go. Your first look at Dishonored 2. Thank you. On behalf of all my teammates at Arkane and Leon who worked so hard to bring this to you, and my dear friend Rafael Colantonio, thank you so much for all the passion you've given the game. In the first Dishonored game, you played Corvo Itano, falsely accused of killing the Empress, the woman he loved and was sworn to protect. And you were blamed for the abduction of their daughter, Emily Caldwin. After escaping on the night of his execution, Corvo is gifted with supernatural powers and dedicates himself to avenging the death of the Empress and restoring young Emily to the throne. As we began to work on Dishonored 2, a single question haunted us. What became of Emily Caldwin? How would her experiences affect her, and what kind of ruler would she become? We envisioned Emily grown up, 25 years of age, and then we began to imagine what she'd be like as a heroic figure, as someone fighting for her life against the forces of deceit. We developed a vision for Emily Caldwin that excited us, and at E3 last year, we shared that vision with the world. Dishonored 2 is set 15 years after the first game. Emily Caldwin rules the Empire, watched over by her father, Corvo Itano.
Imperial Majesty, Emily Caldwin.
Loyal subjects, we're going through a difficult time, but today we honor my mother, the late Jessamine Caldwin. May her memory survive through the ages.
Emily.
You look tired, Father.
Every year, I think the anniversary of Jessamine's death will be easier, but it never is.
I wish Mother was still the Empress. I don't think I'm very good at this.
You're still learning. Don't worry about the rabble-rousers, and we'll catch the Crown Killer, eventually.
People are saying it's you, that these assassinations are a misguided effort to protect me.
No, someone's trying to make us look guilty by targeting your enemies.
I wish I could just run away from all this.
Sometimes you do. You think I don't know about your nights out on the rooftops? Courage. The ceremony will be over soon.
Royal protector and father. I should have passed a law against that combination of titles years ago.
When an otherworldly usurper seizes the throne, the fate of the Empire is left hanging in the balance. Dishonored 2 offers you the choice of playing as Empress Emily Caldwin or the Royal Protector, Corvo Itano. Emily and Corvo are both fully voiced this time, with their own perspectives and emotional responses to the events transpiring around them. Whether you choose to play, whoever you choose to play, you've got to flee Dunwall, your home, and travel to Karnaca in order to unravel the threads of a conspiracy and take back what's yours.
I've got to get away. I should talk to the captain of that ship.
Dishonored is known for unscripted, simulation-driven missions where no two players ever have the same experience. There are many pathways to explore as you penetrate well-defended locations, numerous ways to find and eliminate nefarious targets. In crafting the missions for Dishonored 2, we've put a much greater emphasis on big, interesting themes, either from a gameplay or fictional standpoint, making each mission a wildly unique place to explore. I'll explain a little bit more about that. Today we're going to show you the Dust District, an industrial ruin ravaged by terrible storms that hit at random intervals. In the Dust District, a militant religious faction called the Overseers is at war with the Howler Gang. The leaders of both factions are trying to take each other down. You can side with the Overseers or the Howlers or neither. There are many ways to complete the mission. Everything you see here is rendered in the Void Engine, designed to create atmospheric and exploration-rich spaces. To reach our target, Vice Overseer Byrne, we've got to get past a Grand Guard checkpoint sealed off by a wall of light, a cruel security device reinstated by the Duke of Cirkonos.
Orders from the Duke. We're losing too many people. Good soldiers blinded by that hallucinogenic powder the Howlers used, then stabbed to death or dragged down by the Abbey's hounds. One young lieutenant got hit by an Overseer grenade, and that was it. He was one of the Duke's sister cousins.
Let's hope they do enough damage to each other so the fight goes out of them.
That won't happen until someone manages to kill either Paolo or Vice Overseer.
We've made much greater use of vertical space for Dishonored 2, encouraging players to explore the rooftops above the streets.
Dust out of my ears.
Storm alters visibility for the AI and for the player. A random storm hits and Emily comments on it. Many of the security devices in Dishonored 2 are powered by wind, a unique feature of Karnaca, so here we're switching off the windmill to get through the wall of light. There'll be a lot going on in this next fight. Drop attack, guards climbing and vaulting, combat choke, and Emily using far reach to pull an explosive whale oil tank toward her from a distance.
You! Come here!
All right, let's jump forward closer to our target, Vice Overseer Byrne. The Overseers are fighting the Howler Gang for the hearts and minds of the people of Karnaca. What happens here will influence Karnaca's future and the end games. Here we're going to use Emily's mesmerized power to lull a group of overseers into a stupor, evading combat altogether. Mesmerized, they won't notice Emily or even remember that she was here.
There you are. I feel so empty right now.
Far Reach can be upgraded not only to pull objects from a distance, but also enemies, so you can finish them off in midair. This time, all of Emily's powers, which are new, and all of Corvo's can be fully upgraded using entirely new skill trees, giving you the ability to customize more deeply. If you're new to the Dishonored series, it's all about options and exploration, playing at your own pace. The game has many different pathways through each mission, and also different approaches, stealth or combat, lethal or non-lethal, and a wide array of supernatural powers that will dramatically change the experience as you play. We're very close to Vice Overseer Byrne's office now.
The Duke will topple soon. The Sisters of the Oracular Order have seen it, and I feel it in my bones. So this stalemate with the Howlers must be resolved.
Byrne is giving a briefing using a projector. We're going to plant a stun mine and then link several of the Overseers with Emily's domino power so that whatever happens to one of them will happen to all of them. They share the same fate. Switching off the projector will attract Vice Overseer Byrne's attention, and when the mine affects one Overseer, it will affect all of them. There are many creative ways to use Domino. Now we're going to show you Shadow Walk, another key power for Emily. Shadow Walk is useful for stealth and combat. You saw it in the announced trailer that we made for the game, and you can fully use it in the game. Like all the powers, it can be upgraded in a variety of ways. With Vice Overseer Byrne out of the picture, the leader of the Howlers will owe Emily a favor, and that's just one way to complete the Dust District mission. Before closing today, we want to demonstrate another signature environment from a mission called A Crack in the Slab. It's another example of the missions in Dishonored 2 and how they're built around big, interesting themes. This mission takes place in a ruined manor that's been sealed for several years. At the start, the outsider appears and explains that reality was warped inside this place after an occult event. Your supernatural powers won't work inside the manor, and even time behaves strangely, allowing you to travel back and forth between the ruined present and the past when the manor was lavish and refined. Here we're in the present when the manor's in ruins. Now we've moved backwards, years into the past, when the manor was still inhabited and guarded. Looking through the lenses of the outsider's timepiece, you can see the alternate timeline. This is useful for solving puzzles, as you've seen, but it can also be used to avoid or take down enemies. You can watch enemies in the alternate timeline and then step through to execute your plans. We hope you're going to love the game as much as we do. Thank you. Thank you. I have to once again give a shout out to my team in France. They've worked so hard and they are so passionate about the game and the first game. They're really ready for you to get your hands on it. And you don't have to wait long. All of you can leave your mark on the Empire of the Isles because Dishonored 2 will release on PlayStation 4, the Xbox One, and PC November 11th, 2016. But before I go, I've got one more thing for you. This is the worldwide launch of the Dishonored 2 gameplay trailer. You're seeing it here first. Good night.
Very excited about Dishonored 2. Can I please have another round of applause for the very shy and took off Harvey Smith and everyone at Arkane Studios. Those guys are fantastic. They've been working their butts off. Now, one of the things that Dishonored fans have been asking about a lot is whether or not we're going to do a collector's edition. So tonight, I'm happy to confirm that yes, we will be doing a limited number of Dishonored 2 collector's editions. The collector's edition comes with a very cool replica of Corvo's mask, as well as Emily's ring, and it'll be available through retailers around the globe, but supplies are limited, and as we saw with Fallout 4 last year, and you know who you are, they go out quickly. So, if you want one, I suggest that you pre-order one before they all go away. Also, if you pre-order or digitally pre-purchase any version of Dishonored 2 for a limited time only, you will get a free copy of Dishonored Definitive Edition, which includes the original critically acclaimed game plus all of the add-on content remastered for the current generation of consoles. Cool. Now, games like Dishonored 2 and all of the games that we've shown here tonight don't happen by accident. There are wonderfully talented, dedicated people working hard every day to build games that thrill and inspire all of us. And I want to take a moment to recognize and thank the entire Bethesda team and all of our studios. So if you take a look, you'll see teams from all over the world who are joining us now. Would you please join me in thanking them all for their incredible and dedicated work? Thank you very much. That was great. So, from Quake Champions to Dishonored 2, from The Elder Scrolls Legends to Prey, plus all of the new content for Doom, The Elder Scrolls Online, Fallout 4, and Fallout Shelter, and the latest in virtual reality gaming, it should be another big year for Bethesda. Now, this has already been a great night, and we want to commemorate this moment and give you guys something special to remember it by. So for all of you here in Los Angeles, when you leave tonight, you'll get a special t-shirt. Commemorating this event and all of the games that we've shown. And for those of you watching the stream at home, Adam and Morgan have t-shirts to give away, so keep watching for a chance to get yours. And that is everything we have to show you from this stage. So if you're here with me in the hangar, you can head over to the other side of the lot. If you're watching online, don't go anywhere. Adam and Morgan are about to take over the second half of the stream. For the rest of our showcase, from all of us at Bethesda, thank you all so much for playing our games and joining us. That's it for me. Have a great night. Adam and Morgan, take it away.
All right, thank you so much, Pete, and hello, everyone. I am Adam Sussler, and along with Morgan Webb, I'll be here at BE3+. We're about the next hour interviewing the developers behind the